हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वी आर हियर अगेन विथ आवर सेम चैप्टर, चैप्टर नंबर 11। इन आवर प्रीवियस सेशन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द रिप्रोडक्शन रिप्रोडक्शन इन प्लांट्स। टुडे इन आवर दिस सेशन वी डिस्कस अबाउट द सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन विच वी कैन सी इन प्लांट, देन ऑल्सो डिस्पर्जल ऑफ फ्रूट एंड सीड्स। How types of agents doing dispersal and how types of reproduction in sexual reproduction we can see here in our this session. So now let's start our topics which we have in our textbook. Now artificial methods of vegetative propagation, artificial method. First, we have discussed about the natural methods. Vegetative propagation carried out by human being is called artificial. This type of method is doing by the human being. There are several methods of artificial propagation. Two of the method are stem cutting and grafting. Stem cutting is generally used in plants like rose, champa, sugarcane, etc. A stem cutting is a short piece of a branch of a plant having a node. This cutting, when placed in the soil under suitable conditions, develops roots and leaves. Finally, the complete plants develop. In this method, they first cut the stem and put this stem another place. After a few days, we will get the other plant. This process is doing by the human being. So they are called the artificial method. Then we have activity 11.5. In 11.5, to grow plants from a cutting of rose or champa, take a cutting of rose plant, bury the cutting in the moist soil, water this cutting every day and observe its growth. What do you find? After a few days, roots come out first, followed by new leaves. Sometimes rooting hormone is used to enhance rooting in stem cutting. This type of process you have almost seen around you. In our home garden, we also doing this process for getting another plant from the old plant. This cutting stem is very useful method which always used by human for getting plants. Then layering. Layering is done when the other propagation method are unsuccessful and only a few plants are needed. It is a method in which roots develop on a shoot or branch that is still attached to the parent plant. The stem is cut off from the parent plant only after it has rooted. Layering is generally used in plants like honeysuckle. This type of layering we can see here. This method is doing when we remove the unuseful, unsuccessful plant. When we cut the stem from the parent plant, this process is called the layering. Then we have grafting. You can see here the grafting. In figure, you can also see easily. Grafting is a very common method of artificial vegetative propagation in fruit plant like mango. New varieties can be developed by this method. New variety. From two different varieties, we use these two different varieties and then we get a new variety. New varieties can be developed by this method. In this method, the root portion is taken from one plant. This is called the stalk. The stem portion with several buds is taken from another plant called the scion. The scion is taken from a plant which has the desired features that are needed to be introduced in the root portion. You can see here they join the other part of the plant from the another root part of the plant. The ends of the stalk and the scion are obliquely cut and firmly tied together. They tie together. In this manner, a new plant variety is developed. You can easily see here in figure we have stalk, then we tied the two different stems here. Now sexual reproduction. About the sexual reproduction, the things which we have discussed about all the asexual reproduction, now sexual reproduction. In sexual reproduction, we need two plants. Sexual reproduction is the most common method of reproduction in plants. In this process, two reproductive cells called gametes are produced from the reproductive organs. The two gametes fuse to form a third cell called zygote. The male gamete is a small cell with a nucleus and a little chitoplasm. The female gamete is large with nucleus and more chitoplasm. The fusion of the two gametes is called fertilization. It results in the formation of a zygote. The zygote then undergoes cell division and growth and forms a new individual. The two different gametes come from the male and female. And when two gametes, when we get two gametes from two different things, then we will get a new individual forms. But in sexual reproduction, we always need two different gametes from male and from female. Flowers, glass, corolla, etc. Of these stamens are the male reproductive parts and the pistil. Pistil is the female reproductive part. You can see here the parts which are available in male, and pistil is in the female reproductive part. Then bisexual and unisexual flowers. Most flowers have both male and female reproductive organs as shown in figure 11.10. You can see here 11.11 and 11.12 available. Most flowers have both the male and female reproductive organs. Such flowers are called bisexual flowers because the flowers which have both available male and female, they are called this bisexual flowers. For example, mustard, pea, rose, sunflower, they are the example of bisexual flower. In some flowers like cucumber, papaya, mulberry, we have different parts are present in different flowers. Such flowers are called unisexual flowers. Now structure of stamen and pistil. Here we available structure of stamen and pistil. Each stamen has two parts, a long stalk called the filament and a swollen structure present at the tip of the filament called an anther. The anther produces a powdery substance which consists of very minute pollen grains. Pollen grains are the male gametes. Pollen grains have a two protective coat. You can see a structure of stamen available, anther, filament, then pollen sacs. Pollen grains have a two protective coat. This coat prevents them from drying up. This coating always protects them from drying up. They are also very light and can be carried easily by wind or water. They can easily away by wind and water. A pistil consists of ovary, style, and stigma. Ovary is the basal swollen portion and continues into a long style which ends in a knob-like part called the stigma. You can see here pollen and stigma, style, ovary. In the figure 11.12, you can see here the female gamete, also called like the egg, is formed inside the oil. You can see here the structure are also available. This type of flowers, some have bisexual and some have unisexual. In unisexual, we can get both gametes from male and from female. Then pollination. The male gamete present in the pollen grains need to be transferred to the female gamete present in the ovary to bring about fertilization. The transfer of pollen grains to the stigma of a flower is called pollination. This transfer can take place with the help of wind, water, or insects. Because they cannot go directly. They use some ways and they go by using the help of wind, water and insect. These are called the agents of pollination. So they are called the agents of pollination. Then types of pollination. In pollination, we have two types, self-pollination and cross-pollination. In self-pollination, pollen grains are transferred from anther to stigma, from male to female of the same flower or other flower on the same plant. They are called self-pollination. Cross-pollination, well, the pollen grains are transferred from the anther to the stigma of a flower on another plant. In self-pollination, the process is doing from only one plant. But in cross-pollination, the anther go to stigma from one plant to another plant. They are called the cross-pollination. Then fertilization. After pollination, the fusion of male gametes with the female gamete take place. The process of fusion of male and female gamete is called fertilization. You can see here self-pollination, cross-pollination with example. You will know about more self-pollination and in cross-pollination. In self-pollination, we can see here only one plant. But in cross-pollination, we have two plants, one plant and second plants. In self-pollination, we have here only one plant. But in cross-pollination, they use two plants. Now, during fertilization, the events occur. Which type of events occur? After landing on the stigma, the pollen grains germinate and produce their tubes. The tubes are called pollen tubes. You can see here also the structure of fertilization available, pollen grain, pollen tube, ovary, ovule. Only one pollen tube reaches the ovule. Female gamete is present inside the ovule. Finally, the male gamete fuses with the female gametes, thus fertilization occur. Now, formation of fruit and seed. Our other topic is formation of fruit and seeds. The ovary increases in size and becomes the fruit. When the ovary increases in size, it becomes a ovules become the seeds, the sepals, petals and other part of the flower with are off. How do ovules change into seeds? We have also here figure available in your textbooks, also available 11.16, a seed, how it become in seed. Once a zygote is formed, is divided repeatedly to form an embryo. The embryo is enclosed within a protective seed cord. The embryo enclosed in the seed gives rise to a new plant. Okay, so now dispersal of fruit and seeds. Dispersal of fruit and seeds. A plant produces many fruits. A plant always produces many fruits. If they were all to fall to the ground around the plant which produced them, the seed present inside would try to grow into new plants. There would be hundreds of new plants growing close together and competing with each other for light, water and minerals in the soil. Because when plants want to grow, they need different nutrients. They all get nutrients from the soil. Many would not be able to complete and so they would die. But some can grow. Overrunning is prevented by fruit and seed dispersal. Plant use a variety of method to achieve dispersal of seeds and fruit. The disadvantage of dispersal is that seeds may reach unsuitable surroundings. This is a disadvantage of these things in which they fail to germinate and grow. To overcome this problem, plants reproduce a large number of seeds to be dispersed. This ensured that at least some of them would reach suitable surroundings where they may grow into new plants. Then means of dispersal. We have means of dispersal, wind and animals and water. We have means of dispersal. Seeds and fruit may be carried away by wind, water and animals. We have already learned about the dispersal of seeds The agents which dispersal them, wind, water and rain. Extra wind always damage our plant. You can see here in our figure 11.18. Then water, always water, extra water. Coconut fruit is a good example in which dispersal takes place by water. Coconut is grown on the seashore. The fruit is a large and fibrous. Being fibrous, after falling in water, the fruit floats in it. Water currents carry the fruit away from the parent plant, and when the place where they stop, they start to grow. For example, most of coconut trees we can see on the beach, on the bank of rivers. Then also animals. Dispersal by animals is common in such fruits and seeds which have spiny structure with hooks. You can see here in 11.20 with hooks. Also, we have hooks available. These type of things are called the hooks. In our other classes, we have also discussed about the hooks. Example of kokru. This is the hooks stick to the bodies of passing animals and are carried away several kilometers before they are rubbed off and fall to the ground. In seeds are dispersed by when the fruit brushed with subjects. We can see means of dispersal. These type of agents always dispersal them wind, water and animals. So students, in this chapter we have discussed about the reproduction of plant. All our living organisms which live on earth, they all do reproduction. We have different types, we can see different types are available in reproduction of plants. So our chapter number 11 is completed here. Now we will meet in our next session.